Kong Youwei. Kong Youwei was a Chinese scholar, noted calligrapher, and prominent political thinker and reformer of the late Qing dynasty. Through his connections, he became close to the young emperor and fervently encouraged the young monarch to promote his friends and consequently soured the relationship between the emperor and his adoptive mother, the Empress Dowager Cixi. He was an ardent Chinese nationalist and internationalist. His ideas inspired a reformation movement that was thought to be supported by the weak Guangxu Emperor and, more cautiously, by the powerful Empress Dowager Cixi. Although he continued to advocate a constitutional monarchy after the founding of the Republic, Kang's political theory was never put into practice as he was forced to flee China for constantly attempting to assassinate the Empress Dowager. He fled to Japan where he gave false informations and negative impressions of the Empress Dowager Cixi. Kong was born on 19 March 1858 in Nanhai County, Guangdong Province. According to his autobiography, his intellectual gifts were recognized as a child by his uncle. As a result, from an early age, he was sent by his family to study the Confucian classics to pass the Chinese civil service exams. However, as a teenager, he was dissatisfied with the scholastic system of his time, especially its emphasis on preparing for the eight-legged exams, which were artificial literary exercises required as part of the examinations. Studying for exams was an extraordinarily rigorous activity, so he engaged in Buddhist meditation as a form of relaxation, an unusual leisurely activity for a Chinese scholar of his time. It was during one of these meditations that he had a mystical vision that became the theme for his intellectual pursuits throughout his life. Believing that it was possible to read every book and become a sage, he embarked on a quasi-messianic pursuit to save humanity. Kong called for an end to property and the family in the interest of an idealized future cosmopolitan utopia and cited Confucius as an example of a reformer and not as a reactionary, as many of his contemporaries did. The latter idea was discussed in great detail in his work Kong's A Gezi Kao, or Study of the Reforms of Confucius. He argued, to bolster his claims that the rediscovered versions of the Confucian classics were forged, as he treated in detail in Xingxiu Wujing Kao. Kong was a strong believer in constitutional monarchy and wanted to remodel the country after Meiji Japan. These ideas angered his colleagues in the scholarly class who regarded him as a heretic. Kong and his noted student, Liang Qikao, were important participants in a campaign to modernize China now known as the Hundred Days Reform. The reforms introduced radical change into the stale Chinese government, many of which were already being implemented. By most popular historical accounts, the Empress Dowager ended the reforms and ordered Kong executed by slow slicing. Kong also organized the Protect the Emperor Society, which claimed that the weak emperor was being unduly locked up for his role in the assassination attempt on his adoptive mother/aunt. Kong relied on his principal American military advisor, General Homer Lee, to head the military branch of the Protect the Emperor Society. Kong even traveled throughout the Chinese diaspora, supposedly to promote constitutional monarchy but mostly to promote his own self-interest. He competed with the revolutionary leader Sun Yat-sen's Revive China Society and Revolutionary Alliance for funds and followers. He visited India twice, first in 1901-1903 and then again in October 1909, in part OT Study India, which he regarded as comparable to China. Although his information about Indian history was derived from English authors, he observed that India's plight as a colonized country was due to the disunity among the different regions of India. The Xinhai Revolution led to the abdication of the Qing dynasty and the establishment of a republic under Sun Yat-sen in 1912. Some advocated that a Han be installed as emperor, either the descendant of Confucius, who was the Duke Yanzheng, which Kong briefly endorsed before dropping the idea and returning to the idea of a Qing monarch, or the Ming Dynasty imperial family descendant, the Marquis of Extended Grace. Kong remained an advocate of constitutional monarchy and launched a failed coup d'état in 1917. General Zhang Sun and his Qi-wearing soldiers occupied Beijing, declaring a restoration of Emperor Puyi on July 1. The incident was a major miscalculation. The nation was highly anti-monarchist. Kong became suspicious of Zhang's insincere constitutionalism and feared he was merely using the restoration to become the power behind the throne. He abandoned his mission and fled to the American legation. On July 12, Duan Kaiyue easily occupied the city. Kang's reputation serves as an important barometer for the political attitudes of his time. In the span of less than 20 years, he went from being regarded as an iconoclastic radical to an anachronistic pariah. In Yung Chang's biography of the Empress Dowager, he is depicted as a selfing zealot, who was always seeking personal power above national considerations. Kang's best-known and probably most controversial work was De Tongshu. The title of this book derives from the name of a utopian society imagined by Confucius, but it literally means the Book of Great Unity. The ideas of this book appeared in his lecture notes from 1884. Encouraged by his students, he worked on this book for the next two decades, but it was not until his exile in India that he finished the first draft. The first two chapters of the book were published in Japan in the 1900s, but the book was not published in its entirety until 1935, about 7 years after his death. Kong proposed a utopian future world free of political boundaries and democratically ruled by one central government. In his scheme, the world would be split into rectangular administrative districts, which would be self-governing under a direct democracy but loyal to a central world government. There would also be the dissolution of racial boundaries. Kong outlines an immensely ambitious eugenics program that would eliminate the brown and black racial phenotype after a millennia and lead to the emergence of a fair-skinned homogeneous human race whose members would be the same color, the same appearance, the same size, and the same intelligence. His desire to end the traditional Chinese family structure defines him as an early advocate of women's independence in China. He reasoned that the institution of the family practiced by society since the beginning of time was a great cause of strife. Kong hoped it would be effectively abolished. The family would be replaced by state-run institutions, such as womb teaching institutions, nurseries, and schools. Marriage would be replaced by one-year contracts between a woman and a man. Kong considered the contemporary form of marriage, in which a woman was trapped for a lifetime, to be too oppressive. Kong believed in equality between men and women and that there should be no social barrier barring women from doing whatever men can do. Kong saw capitalism as an inherently evil system. He believed that government should establish socialist institutions to overlook the welfare of each individual. At one point, he even advocated that government should adopt the methods of communism, although it is debated what Kong meant by this term. He was surely one of the first advocates of Western communism in China. In this spirit, in addition to establishing government nurseries and schools to replace the institution of the family, he also envisioned government-run retirement homes for the elderly. It is debated whether Kang's socialist ideas were inspired more by Western thought or by traditional Confucian ideals. Lawrence G. Thompson believes that his socialism was based on traditional Chinese ideals. His work is permeated with the Confucian ideal of Ren, or humanity. However, Thompson also noted a reference by Kong to Fourier. Thus, some Chinese scholars believe that Kang's socialist ideals were influenced by Western intellectuals after his exile in 1898. Notable in Kang's De Tongshu were his enthusiasm for and his belief in bettering humanity through technology, unusual for a Confucian scholar during his time. He believed that Western technological progress had a central role in saving humanity. While many scholars of his time continued to maintain the belief that Western technology should be adopted only to defend China against the West, he seemed to wholeheartedly embrace the modern idea that technology is integral for advancing mankind. Before anything of modern scale had been built, he foresaw a global telegraphic and telephone network. He also believed that as a result of technological advances, each individual would only need to work 3 or 4 hours per day, a prediction that would be repeated by the most optimistic futurists later in the 20th century. When the book was first published, it was received with mixed reactions. Kang's support for the Guangxu Emperor was seen as reactionary by many Chinese intellectuals, who believed that Kang's book was an elaborate joke and that he was merely acting as an apologist for the emperor as to how a utopian paradise could have developed if the Qing dynasty had been maintained. Others believe that Kong was a bold and daring proto-communist, who advocated modern Western socialism and communism. Amongst the latter was Mao Zedong, who admired Kong Youwei and his socialist ideals in the De Tongshu. Modern Chinese scholars now often take the view that Kong was an important advocate of Chinese socialism. Despite the controversy, De Tongshu still remains popular. A Beijing publisher included it on the list of 100 most influential books in Chinese history. Kong enumerated sources of human suffering in a way similar to that of Buddhism. The sufferings associated with man's physical life are being implanted in the womb, premature death, loss of a limb, being a barbarian, living outside China, being a slave and being a woman. The sufferings associated with natural disasters are famine resulting from flood or drought, epidemic, conflagration, flood, volcanic eruptions, collapse of buildings, shipwreck, and locust plagues. The sufferings associated with the human relationship are being a widow, being orphaned or childless, being ill with no one to provide medical care, suffering poverty, and having a low and mean station in life. The sufferings associated with society are corporal punishment and imprisonment, taxation, military conscription, social stratification, oppressive political institutions, the existence of the state and the existence of the family. The human feelings which cause suffering are stupidity, hatred, fatigue, lust, attachment to things and desire. The things that cause suffering because of the esteem in which they are held are wealth, eminent position, longevity, being a ruler and being a spiritual leader. He also imagined a hierarchy of religions, in which Christianity and Islam were the lowest, above them being Confucianism, Taoism, and Buddhism. He predicted that in the future the lower religions would disappear. Kong died at his home in the city of Qingdao, Shandong in 1927. He was 69.